Hey, what's up everybody, and welcome back to another episode of News Dose, where I give you all of the latest news in the game industry. And now that we're in February, I'm sure several of us are hoping for a PlayStation 5 event where they reveal the PlayStation 5, its specs, games, and maybe even a price. Well, Sony has some news on this topic, though it is a little bit odd and maybe not what a lot of fans were hoping for. So we're going to go over that here in just a moment and what exactly PlayStation's strategy is going forward. Plus, there is several other things to talk about as well, including Scalebound, the cancelled Xbox game that was being developed by Platinum, and if it could ever be revived. Also, a possible Medieval 2 remake, some more information on PlayStation's first-party game, Dreams, as well as Phantasy Star Online 2, so stay tuned for all of that as well. But as I said before, what exactly is PlayStation's strategy going forward? Well, we did get some snippets of information directly from Sony today that not only talked about their pricing strategy for the PlayStation 5, but also a mysterious website that popped up revealing they are not ready to reveal the PlayStation 5. And I am being serious about that. I'm not sure I've ever seen an announcement like this where a PlayStation 5 website did go up, which prompts fans that they are not quite ready to unveil the PlayStation 5. But however, if you want to be among the first to get news on the PlayStation 5, well, you can sign up for a newsletter on this website. Honestly though, even if you do sign up for this newsletter, I imagine you will not get details ahead of other people that haven't signed up. It will likely be after they either have an event showing the PlayStation 5, or hey, they may even do another article release, which is how they unveiled some of the PlayStation 5 specs last year. So I really don't think this newsletter is going to be very beneficial to fans. I mean, that's just my opinion. I don't know that as a fact, but I don't think it's going to be like you're going to get news ahead of time. The big thing here really is in the wording, which is how it says they are not ready to unveil the PlayStation 5 quite yet. And to many, that may be a little surprising, as almost everybody seemed to have believed it would be revealed in February. But with the wording here, it does imply that it may not be in February after all. I myself predicted that they would unveil the PlayStation 5 in February because not only was the PlayStation 4 revealed in February, you know, a long time ago, but also you have these miniature events going on in New York City as of this moment, and it's going to be for 30 days. I was thinking maybe Sony could hold a big PlayStation 5 event on the final day of those miniature events, but with this statement by PlayStation, it looks like I'll be wrong here. Though that is one thing about this newfound information, as several insiders was claiming there would be a PlayStation event in February, but if it's true that PlayStation won't be here, well, that will also reveal how little some of these so-called insiders really know about the PlayStation 5. There is a reason I have continuously said that I haven't trusted PlayStation insiders recently. There is just a lot of information going around that seems sketchy at best. With that said, when could the PlayStation 5 event theoretically happen if it's not in February? Well, it seems like PlayStation is holding their cards close to the vest here, which is where their pricing strategy comes in. So yes, Sony did talk about their price strategy for the PlayStation 5, as Chief Financial Officer Hiroki Totoki said they can't control the price level and had this to say about the PlayStation 5 price point. What is not very clear or visible is because we are competing in that space, so it's very difficult to discuss anything about the price at this point of time. And depending upon the price level, we may have to determine the promotion that we are going to deploy and how much costs we are prepared to pay. So what exactly does this statement mean? Does Sony really not have a price point set for the PlayStation 5 yet? Well, no. I believe they have a good idea of what they want it to be, but here he is talking about how they are competing in the space, which of course is the gaming space, and their main competitors is Xbox, and to a lesser extent you have Nintendo as well. From the sounds of things, it appears Sony is trying to wait for Microsoft to reveal the Xbox Series X price point before they finalize the price point of the PlayStation 5. This is a similar strategy that they used this generation with the PlayStation 4, as they chose to undercut the Xbox One with a $400 price tag, which was taking a loss on each console sold. It now appears they may try to do the same thing with the PlayStation 5, but it's very possible that Xbox may be trying to do the same thing. So the two may be in a bit of a stalemate as of this moment, daring the other to reveal more information first, which, while maybe smart business, it may make for a slow reveal on these consoles. It is very possible that even when Sony decides to reveal the PlayStation 5, that they may leave information out such as the final price point. That is assuming that the reveal of the PlayStation 5 is before E3. I think by this point we kind of know that the Xbox Series X will be at E3, so could Sony wait until after E3 to show the PlayStation 5? I wouldn't rule that out either, honestly, though I am hoping for a PlayStation 5 reveal before that time. Like I said though, it just may lack key details such as the price. Either way, PlayStation's pricing strategy as well as its reveal seems to be built around patience, and so we as fans may also have to have patience on this one. Let me know what you think of this strategy though in the comments below. And since we are on the topic of PlayStation, we do have a PlayStation game related announcement, the first of which is about Dreams, the game developed by the Little Big Planet developer Media Molecule. As we all know by this point, the main focus of Dreams is in its creation tools, which allows players to create practically anything that they want to. In all honesty, the creator tools are very impressive, but the thing is, these type of games may not be for everybody. Many fans instead want a single player experience that is developed by the developers themselves, and well, Little Big Planet was very good at this. While yes, you could create your own levels in Little Big Planet, it still did have a big focus on its single player experience, which I thought it was really good. Especially Little Big Planet 2 and Little Big Planet Vita, which are some of my favorite 2D platformers of all time. The thing is, we haven't really seen that same amount of focus on Dreams as of just yet, because we have seen very little about its single player campaign. Well, they did reveal a little bit more about it today, and here is a few bits of information we can take going into the release. So Dreams will be roughly 2 to 3 hours long. Those levels cannot be edited, but however, can be recreated as everything in the campaign is using the creation tools given to the player. I mean, it's not a very long game, and I know that's going to turn off a lot of people, but I think for the more creative people, they will end up liking this game just for its creation tools alone, as they do look phenomenal. I don't know though, for me, I've always preferred developer-made games myself, and games like Little Big Planet, Mario Maker, or even Project Spark, it's cool being able to develop a game yourself, but usually user-created content is not nearly as good as what the developers make themselves. Granted, it may be different here with Dreams. I mean, again, the creation tools are just phenomenal. Nonetheless, Dreams will release on February 14th, so we won't have to wait too much longer to try it out for ourselves. Now, something I wanted to talk about yesterday, which I didn't really get to talk about all that much, was the possibility of a Scalebound revival. Of course, Scalebound was a passion project by Platinum Games and was being published by Xbox, but it was cancelled a few years ago by Xbox. To this day, it is probably one of the most controversial decisions by Xbox, as it has left a lot of fans very upset. Platinum Games has a lot of passionate fans, and Hideki Kamiya, the creative director behind Scalebound, has put out a lot of excellent games in the past, including, you have Resident Evil 2, Okami, Bayonetta, and Wonderful 101, which we just saw have a very successful Kickstarter, so a lot of people were kind of expecting that same type of quality. Unfortunately though, there did seem to be some development problems with Scalebound, and even when we saw footage of Scalebound on stage, it had a lot of very noticeable framerate issues. There was very clearly something wrong going on here, and maybe it was just too ambitious for the original Xbox One at the time. I mean, there's also rumors that Platinum Games was using Scalebound's funds for other projects at the time, such as Nier Automata, but even then, after Xbox cancelled Scalebound, both Xbox and Platinum Games still seems to have a good relationship with one another. Hideki Kamiya even sounds like he takes a lot of blame for the cancellation of Scalebound rather than blaming Xbox, and of course we now know that Xbox tried to acquire Platinum Games last year as well. So it does seem like neither has any major issue with one another, and that's the thing, because now we got some new information, because in an interview with Eurogamer, Atsushi Inaba from Platinum Games had this to say when asked about a Scalebound revival. Again, it's a good question, but this was an intellectual property that belongs 100% to Microsoft. Whatever happens with this project, we can't really do anything with unless Microsoft leaves us. But it's a game that we fell in love with and love. If the opportunity arises, it's something we would love to return to. So there it is. Even to this day, Platinum Games would still like to return to the once very promising, but possibly too ambitious project, Scalebound. So that begs the question, is there a possibility that Scalebound could be revived? Well, I think it's possible, even if very doubtful. I'm not sure if Microsoft would be willing to sell the IP to Platinum, as I'm sure they sank a lot of money into this game, but Xbox and Platinum could try to work together once again. Scalebound would of course run much better on Xbox Series X, and the way Xbox is run today is also different today than what they used to be. I mean, they do have a much better funding as well. Xbox Game Pass is also a thing, so that could be very beneficial for a game like Scalebound instead of only relying on retail sales. They could also let Platinum Games do what they want and scrap the multiplayer component and only focus on the single player. In all likelihood, this will likely not happen, but I do find this to be very interesting. If Xbox did in fact try to acquire Platinum Games last year, we at least know they had discussions with each other, and Scalebound could have possibly been in one of those conversations. If anything, what a story that would make if we saw Scalebound return for the Xbox Series X. Moving on, there is also a rumor of another PlayStation remake, and this one kind of surprised me. In 2019, PlayStation released a remake of Medieval, an old game that was on the original PlayStation, but at the same time, Sony didn't seem to really advertise this remake all that much. It also didn't review all that well, and I think a lot of people kind of believed it had failed, or at least until the Medieval composer responded to some comments on Twitter that not only revealed that Medieval did not perform poorly, but it also seems he is teasing a Medieval 2 remake. Of course, this is little information to go off by this point, but hey, you never know. Maybe we hear about a Medieval 2 remake for the PlayStation 5 at some point. And speaking of success stories, Namco Bandai's RPG Codevein went on to sell 1 million copies worldwide, which is, I mean, that's really great news. I haven't actually got the chance to play this one myself, but I always liked the way it looked. It almost looks like an anime Dark Souls or something like that. But unfortunately, it did seem to have quite a bit of criticism when it launched, but luckily, it did find some success as well. And hey, maybe this success could help it get a sequel and fix some of the complaints that the first installment had. Now, one last topic before we wrap this episode up, but Phantasy Star Online 2 will also be heading to Steam as well as Xbox and Windows 10. We previously already knew about Xbox and Windows 10, but it has now officially been announced for Steam as well, which is great news for PC gamers. Steam is the go-to store on PC for a lot of fans, me included, so I'm glad to hear this, especially for a game that people have been waiting for what feels like forever. Anyways though, that's it for this episode, but if you liked the video, don't forget to hit the bell notification and subscribe button for more content just like this. Peace out.